Hello everyone! Today, we're tackling a big project. We're going to teach you how to create, high definition, digital humans. Take a look. This is the very first digital human character I've seriously created, although I've made them before. They were just for fun. I believe that after wan 2.2 was released, digital human technology, or the ability to naturally present a digital human character in our videos, has become very mature. Take a look. These are some vlog-like scenes I simulated for this digital human. They include scenarios from both daily life and work. So, how do we create this? Let's do a simple analysis. Essentially, to create a high-definition digital human, we only need to solve two problems. First, consistency. Second, visual quality. Visual quality involves many aspects, including color, lighting, and actions. Also, note that every scene I've created is high-definition. Its facial features and details are all displayed with great clarity. Therefore, to achieve this perfect digital human effect, we use a very wide range of technologies. This video cannot cover all the technical details. In this lesson, we will mainly focus on the workflow part. Other significant technical details will be explained in separate videos. Next, let's look at how this digital human is created. The first aspect is Lora. The tool I used for training is still a toolkit. My dataset was very small. Only 10 images. After 3,000 training steps, let's take a look. The final result we saw is absolutely fantastic. We will have a separate video to discuss this part. What is the second technical section? It's about prompt words. You'll notice that the videos I generated have very high visual quality. Therefore, we need to have high quality prompt words. These prompt words weren't written by me alone. No one relies solely on human ability to write prompts anymore. Therefore, I must have a high-quality prompt word generator. Training this generator is not particularly simple. So, I won't be able to explain it in this video. We will have a separate video to tell you how to collect training data, how to generate prompt word engineering, how to write this prompt word generator, how to test it. This concludes the second major section. Once these two prerequisites are met, we move into the workflow section. All right, next. Let's first look at this workflow. This workflow is actually very simple and doesn't require excessive explanation. Let's see the effect generated by this workflow. Note that its current resolution is 480 by 832. It's a vertical format. Take a look. The quality is still relatively high. However, if you zoom in, you'll notice that the character's details still have many rough edges. So, we will have a post-processing step later. This is also a very interesting technical point. Although, it might seem insignificant here, if you understand our approach to upskilling, it will be very helpful for effectively using the wan 2.2 model. We'll discuss this later. First, let's look at the part about generating the base animation. First, let's look at model loading. This is very simple. I refactored it a bit. This is our high noise model, which is the official FP8 version. I've previously talked about an optimization method, so I've applied it here as well. First, I used LaTeX to V's Lora, mainly for acceleration. Second, I used my own Lora. Please note that in this Lora, I did not set the weight to 1, but rather to 0.75. This way, we will naturally lose some consistency, but it will effectively increase the diversity of the image. If you constrain it too much, especially since my dataset was small, only 10 images, it often leads to overfitting during training. Try not to set the weight to maximum. If you do, you'll find that your image will be quite rigid, and the character will also appear rigid. Additionally, I used CFG 0 star here. I saved it as a low noise model, similarly to Lora's R added. Then, I used SageMaker. Attention. Next, we have our encoder and our V. And then, we need a high quality prompt word. This is generated by our prompt word generator. Next is our sampling section. This is relatively simple. First, I used NAJ, primarily in the high noise model, to perform sampling for the high noise model. It's also 8 steps. The first 4 steps are for composition, and the last 4 steps are for refinement. The CFG is 1.0. Our sampling algorithm uses LCM, and the scheduler uses Simple. Pay attention to the details of this application in the composition stage. We need to add noise, but no noise is added in the optimization stage. Then, we can generate this effect. Take a look, it's fantastic. However, you might have also noticed that our current resolution is 480 by 832, but my video's resolution is 720 by 1280. If I directly try to run 720 by 1280, it won't work. Even running Hub with 24 gigabytes of RAM might struggle. Therefore, we need something, an upscaling section. So, the second key skill everyone needs to master is this upscaling part. How do we do this? Let's look at the quality first. The quality is very high. If we zoom in, take a look at the facial details, you will also find that there are some changes. For example, the color of the glasses has changed. So, we are not doing a purely mechanical upscaling. So, how is this upscaling achieved? Actually, it's so simple that it's hardly worth mentioning. First, we take the generated video. Then, note that the entire model I loaded is a low-noise model. There are no changes, of course. I used my optimization methods, but it is indeed a low-noise model. Then we move on to the prompt word section. For this prompt word, I just wrote my trigger word, glasses woman. I forgot to mention this earlier. Actually, in wan2.1 or 2.2, this trigger word isn't particularly important, but it's best to include it. You'll find that in the video I just generated, I placed glasses woman at the beginning. Additionally, in the subject description later, I also used glasses woman. The reason is that during training, in my dataset, I consistently used glasses underscore woman. Right? Let's go back to the workflow. Then, I perform denoising. This denoising process is actually the same as before. However, you need to pay attention. You must add noise here. Because in the previous generation workflow, noise was not added. It's essential to add it now. If you don't, there will be problems. Since I'm currently upscaling and generating a new latent space, the noise I have is actually not enough. Therefore, I need to add it. And I'm not starting from step 4. But from step 5. So, it's the last 3 steps that perform sampling. The first 5 steps remain unchanged. Since this is an advanced sampler, the denoising coefficient can only be expressed in this way. I'm too lazy to switch to the standard sampler. Then, we perform the decoding. This is the effect. Take a look. It's fantastic. Some might say that this workflow doesn't seem particularly special. Indeed, but you need to note that to use or create this workflow, you must have a very deep understanding of low-noise models. Have you noticed that in the wan2.2 video generation workflow, the low-noise model is used for refinement, right? So, whether in image generation or video generation, the low-noise model can be used for optimization, and its optimization capability is very high. Once you realize this, then looking at this workflow becomes quite simple. Since I used the last 3 steps for denoising, the denoising coefficient is still relatively large. Therefore, there are more changes in the character. I provided many details to make this video very clear. However, I have my Lora here, which ensures character consistency. So, this is a very valuable point of this workflow. Another point is that when we use wan2.1 Lora on wan2.2, you'll find that the effect is excellent. I currently do not recommend everyone to train wan2.2 Lora, because many people are still exploring if there are any pitfalls, as the model has just been released. So, let's wait a bit. Later, we will train Wan to point to Lora. Finally, let's elaborate further. Some say their model can't run, especially with Wan 2.2. When you load both a high denoising and low denoising model together, your computer crashes, right? It simply won't run locally. But have you noticed that it's essentially a 2-stage denoising process? You can separate it. So, next I'll teach you a solution if you have insufficient VRAM, but still want to run Wan 2.2. You can do it this way by splitting it into parts. Let's look at the first stage. You can handle it this way. Please note, I only have the high noise model prompt words here. I won't go into detail on this. And for sampling, it's also just high noise model sampling. So, in this workflow, I only loaded one model, which is an FP8 model. I did not load the low denoising one. Then, after sampling, you generate a latent, you can save it. Take a look, save it, using save latent. Here, I also took another path, which is to use VDecode to generate a video from it. This video, as I mentioned before, is a simulation. The signal-to-noise ratio is 1. With a signal-to-noise ratio of 1, you actually can't see the image. Therefore, what you see are just snowflake-like noise patterns. So why did I decode it? It's actually unnecessary. Once you save this latent, you can use it in the next workflow. So, where is the problem? It's like this. Under normal logic, I would definitely use this node called load latent. This is also a native comfy Y node. However, using this to load, it doesn't have an upload function. You can only find it in the list if you place it in your input folder. But since this is a cloud-based platform, I have no way to upload it there. So, what can I do? I can only simulate it for everyone. Therefore, here, I decode it into a video, which means I perform a V encode and then another encode. After encoding, we then proceed with load noising. Note that in the second stage, there is only the LoRa noising model. Therefore, I can set the frame rate to 121 frames. Then, we perform denoising using two separate workflows. Note that the image quality I get this way will definitely have problems. This is because video encoding is not like text encoding, where text encoding shouldn't have errors. But for video, this encoding is a process of downsampling and upsampling. Essentially, a large video is compressed into a smaller dimension and then decompressed. So, it first undergoes a decode and then an encode. This will cause some flickering in the image. So, you'll find that the video is produced, but the quality is not high. However, if you directly load the latent and perform load noising sampling, then there will be no problems. Therefore, we have broken down the original large workflow into two smaller workflows. Essentially, we are trading time for space, meaning you can run it without needing such a large VRA. Of course, finally, if you connect our upscaling workflow, you'll get a relatively high-quality video. The content of this lesson was very extensive, mainly focused on generating these high-quality digital humans or virtual characters. It involved Lora, prompt word generator, video generation, video upscaling. So, the content is quite rich and covers various aspects. You can explore it yourselves. Alright, that's all for today. Follow me to become someone who understands AI.